Before we go on partnering service, I just want to take a moment to say something. Last night, a couple of us were at a different church service, and the church is transitioning. It's a well-known church in the area, pretty popular. And we were there as servants to bring forth the word of God that God has for that church. And as we was in that church, God spoke and he said, take a look around. Take a look around and notice that I'm not just shifting one church. I'm not just changing one church. I'm not transitioning one building. I'm moving my body as a whole. And he said for me to tell you this because he's getting ready to do some great things. And he wants you to be prepared for it. He wants you to be ready for it. See, it'd be one thing if it was just Sure Foundation going through some changes. Going through some changes. But it's not. It's this church. It's the church on the corner. It's the church across the street. It's the church up the street. So what that is saying is God's whole body is changing. And so we have to pay attention to that. Because what that is God is doing a new thing. And if you're not careful, and if you're not lined up with what he says to do, you're going to get left behind. That is difficult for me to say. Because when God gave me the charge to the prophets today, he said to encourage, to exhort, to edify my body. That was the only instruction that was given. But then he began to tell me, he said, in order for that to take place, I got to make straight what is crooked. I got to lay down the road which has been dirt. I got to set some things straight. So, what that means is God has given me one word when I saw him for this church today. I said, God, what do you have for your people? What do you want? And he said, tell them they're out of relationship. And I said, they go to church every Sunday. They go to prayer. They're trying hard. They're watching what they say. They're not drinking as much anymore. They're not cussing as much anymore. He said, they're out of relationship. Because see, relationship with God is not about task. It's not about duty. It's about obedience. Obedience. And God has said that we need to get back into relationship. Amen. So that's the word that he's giving me today. And as he speaks, please don't see me. I just reiterate that. I just see what he has for you to say. So if I can get everyone to bow their heads real quick. When it came to sharing this subject, I said, God, how do you tell people that are doing what they're supposed to do, what they think they're supposed to do, that there's something missing? And I said, you simply tell them. See, relationship means you have a connection. You have a kinship. Or it's covered by blood. And in our case, We have both. We have a connection with God. Not because we're Israelites and we were chosen, but because of our faith. Our faith. So what God showed me was there were different aspects to our faith which helped with our relationship. And I said, all right, Lord. All right. And he said, Ty, this message is different. I know it's hard, it's different. Because this is my word. This is not a teaching. This is not something that you study and you find and you put together and you connect. But this is my word. So what is to be said is going to be a lot of word. And I'm going to start, and some of you may know this, in Isaiah 55. And he says, come, everyone who is thirsty, come to the waters, and you without money, come, buy and eat. Come buy wine and milk without money and without cost. Why do you spend money on what is not food, and your wages on what does not satisfy? Listen carefully to me and eat what is good, and you will enjoy the choicest of foods. Pay attention and come to me. Listen so that you will live. I will make an everlasting covenant with you, the promises assured to David. Since I have made him a witness to the peoples, a leader and commander for the peoples. So you will summon a nation you do not know, and nations who do not know you will run to you. For the Lord your God, even the Holy One of Israel, has glorified you. Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call to him while he is near. Let the wicked one abandon his way, and the sinful one his thoughts. Let him return to the Lord, so he may have compassion on him, and to our God, for he will freely forgive. For my thoughts are not your thoughts, and your ways are not my ways. This is the Lord's declaration. For as heaven is higher than earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts. For just as rain and snow fall from heaven and do not return there, without saturating the earth and making it germinate and sprout, and providing seed to sow and food to eat, so my word that comes from my mouth will not return to me empty, but it will accomplish what I please and will prosper in what I send it to do. You will indeed go out with joy and be peaceably guided. The mountains and the hills will break into singing before you, and all the trees of the field will clap their hands. Instead of the thorn bush, a cypress will come up, and instead of the briar, a myrtle will come up. It will make a name for the Lord as an everlasting sign that will not be destroyed. Amen. That sounds like a lot, but that's what God has on his heart for you. He wants you to be with him all the time. Amen.
Yes.
All the time. He doesn't want you to come in here Sunday morning and get a word. He wants you to walk in the word.
Yes.
Amen. He wants you to be washed in the word. Amen. He wants you to be cleansed in the word. He wants the word to come forth out of you, bubbling over, spewing over. He wants you to be in relationship with him.
Yes.
See, in this day and age, we've taken tradition and religion to mean relationship, and it doesn't. We can come in here and not have all this stuff up here, not have a microphone, not have any of that, but we still have relationship.
Yes.
So if I can't sing, if I can't hold a tune, I can lift up my head and praise the Lord, because that's relationship. And what God has said is that he is getting lost in everything that we're doing. And he's calling for us to come back to him a relationship. Whether you're on your job, whether you're in your car, whether you're riding a bus, whether you're walking the street, he wants relationship. See, God is in the wind. When the wind is blowing and you're walking down the street, he's speaking. But are you looking for him? Are you listening to what he's saying to you? Before you get up and put your shoes on and brush your teeth, are you saying, God, what do you have for me today? Are you seeking him in every direction and aspect of your life? Are you simply getting up and being a sometime Christian? God has asked for us to represent him. He has chosen us.
Yes, he has.
And I said, God, how does your relationship show for them? He said, I see no appreciation. None. They don't look back and thank me, except when they want to. He said, I want it all the time. I'm a jealous God. I want someone to love me as I love them. And I said, God, that's hard for us to do. Because I know I couldn't give my son up for anyone. And he said, I don't ask that. I ask that you try. See, they're walking around not trying. They're concerned about day-to-day things. And that's why you can't tell the difference between my chosen and the world. Because they're not concerned with my thoughts. They're not concerned with what I'm supposed to be doing or what God says to do. But they're concerned with earning a paycheck and making a meal. And he said, don't they know that I've created all of this? I'm the God of the heavens and the earth. And that I have everything in the palm of my hand. And they're concerned with what they see instead of me. I said, okay. He said, Christian is discipleship. It's discipleship. The reason why people cannot see the difference between a Christian and a Mormon and a Jehovah's Witness who don't proclaim that my son is their Lord and Savior. Who don't proclaim that he's the Messiah, that he has come and he has given them and died for them and raised again, and now they are connected in relationship because of the blood that he shed? That's our relationship. We weren't born into relationship. We were covered under relationship. I'm not an Israelite. I'm not from the tribe. And none of us can trace if we were back that far. But God said, you don't have to be concerned with that. Be concerned with me.
Yes.
And we've lost him and all that. And I said, God, what does that mean? What does that mean for your people? When you say relationship, what does that mean? Are there different aspects? I asked my husband, so what is that different aspect? He said, well, you got a husband and wife. You got father, son, you got a friend, co-worker, all these other kind of relationships. And God said, I am not like them. I am not like them. So your relationship with me should be even more special than your relationship with them. If you are a married person, amen. If you're a married person and you talk to your spouse every day, and you go that day without talking to God, you're out of order. You are out of order.
Yes.
If you are a parent and you talk to your child every day and you go that day without talking to God, you're out of order. Because God is first. And in him, everything else will be added to us. Well, Ty, how can you say that? Turn to Matthew. He said, I'm Matthew.
I just need to do it.
Ms. Matthew 6. It's not going to give me. I have a lot of pages that he gave me. Let's see here. If I can. Let me see. I'm using Pastor's Bible, and it's a little sticky because it's brand new thanks to Miss Tamara. All right, I'm going to say it's Matthew 6. He says, this is why I tell you don't worry about your life. He didn't say don't worry about your job. He didn't say don't worry about your kids. He said your life. What you will eat, what you will drink, about your body, what you will wear. Isn't life more than food and the body more than clothing? Look at the birds of the sky. They don't sow or reap or gather into barns, yet your heavenly Father feeds them. Aren't you worth more than they are? Can any of you add a single cubit to his height by worrying? No. And why do you worry about clothes? Learn how the wildflowers of the field grow. They don't labor or spin thread. Yet I tell you that not even Solomon in all his splendor was adorned like one of these. Yes. If that's how God clothes the grass of the field, which is here today and thrown into the furnace tomorrow, won't he do much more for you? You a little faith. So don't worry, saying what will we eat or what will we drink or what will we wear? For the idolaters eagerly seek all these things, and your heavenly Father knows that you need them. But seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be provided for you. Therefore, don't worry about tomorrow, because tomorrow will worry about itself. Each day has enough trouble of its own. Amen?
Amen.
So, he's saying that you're supposed to be my people who are called by my name, but yet you're worried about what you wear, what you eat, and everything else but him and what he's doing. God has asked for your full attention, for your full relationship. I said, God, at what cost? What cost does that mean? He said, that means that some will be persecuted. Some will be tried. There will be tribulation. But know this, if they did that to our Lord and Savior, who are you? Who are you?
Yes.
Because they persecuted him. They sought after him. They chased him down. Because of what he said and what he did. If you don't have persecution in your life, then you might want to check if you're living according to what God said to live. Because that's the mark that you know what you're supposed to do. And I don't mean something that you created. I mean something that's called, because when I bring my Bible on my job and they say I can't read my Bible, then I'm in danger of being fired. That's persecution for his name's sake.
Yes, it is.
There's a difference between that and I just spent too much money at the grocery store and now I don't have enough to pay my bill. That's a difference. See, we are thinking that the things that we cause for ourselves are the persecution in which God is bringing. No, that's not for his name's sake. Now, yes, we can give him the glory because we caused the situation and his grace and mercy covered us when he didn't have to. But persecution for his name's sake is something totally different that we don't even understand, because we're taking it lightly that we have freedom here in this country to even praise him. Well, persecution is for his name's sake is when I'm in church every Sunday and I'm praying and I'm living a godly life and my family don't want to be around me because they can't stand the words that come out of my mouth when I tell them you shouldn't drink, you shouldn't smoke, you shouldn't cuss, because that's not of God. And now I can't get on the phone and talk to my parents the way I want to. That's persecution. Not is my bills paid. That is not, he said, he's going to already take care of that. See, the persecution comes when you get past the bills. When you get past the, okay, I forgot that he got that. So you know what? I have faith he's got that. Now let me keep moving. Oh, they're coming to take my furniture in the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus. Then you start falling and you start being broken and the persecution is coming because now I'm standing. faith. Too many of us, when it starts to come, we turn and go the other way. But God has said, that's part of relationship with me. Persecution. If you're not receiving persecution, you're not in relationship completely. It's like a child with their parent. A parent has got to discipline them from time to time. If they don't, that child goes haywire. So you got to remind them, I'm the parent and you're the child. Do what I told you to do. And if we're looking at the persecution that God is sending us through as this painful, don't ask to take you out of the fire. Ask him to turn it up. Because if they turn it up, he shows up.
Hallelujah.
We're walking around here defeating attitudes. Like we are lost and we're not better than it. We are better. You want to know why you're better? Because you have God in you.
Yes.
You have a weapon that nobody else has. God in you. They should be asking you, what is that? Who is that? How can I get that? Are you presenting your body as a living sacrifice? I said, okay, Lord. What does that have to do with your relationship? And he said, because all of this is part of love in me. Loving me. Remove your idea of what love is. See, we love according to what we know, but not how he asked to be loved. He said, present your body as a living sacrifice. That's love for him. That's in what you do, what you say, what you think, everything you touch. That's not this part only on Sunday. He said he wants all of it. All of it. I said, okay, Lord, what does that mean? What does that mean? Turn with me to Revelation. Revelation, please. I just want to mention that as I read Revelation, I'm going to read chapter 2, but God said to read this too. Blessed is the one who reads, and blessed are those who hear the words of this prophecy. And keep what is written in it, because the time is near. He said not to be concerned with the day of when time is near, but know that it's coming. And his concern for you is that before he comes, make sure you're in relationship, not religion.
That's right.
Relationship, not tradition. Relationship, not fear. You say, well, what exactly is relationship? Chapter 2. To the angel of the church in Ephesus wrote, the one who holds the seven stars in his right hand and who walks among the seven gold lampstands says, I know your works, your labor, and your endurance, and that you cannot tolerate evil. Yeah, good church. Now I'm not going to elaborate too much on this because pastors have already talked. So y'all know the difference. Yeah, good church. And please know that we're talking about the body. Not just your foundation, but the body, right? You have tested those who call themselves apostles and are not. And you have found them to be liars. You have also possessed endurance and have tolerated many things because of my name. And have not grown weary, but I have this against you. You have abandoned the love you had at first. Remember then how far you have fallen. Repent and do the works you did at first. Otherwise, I will come to you. When God says relationship, he said love. Love of him. Love of him above anything else. Because it's the love of him that will give you joy. It's the love of him that will give you peace. It's the love of him that will give you comfort. It's the love of him that will make you stronger. That will make you endure longer, that will make you stand. chose us first, and he's waiting for us to choose him. And every time we don't choose him, we don't appreciate the love that he's given us. We're out of relationship. When I get up in the morning and the first thing I think about is what I'm going to eat for breakfast, I'm not in relationship. Because God created me to serve him. So I need to be meditating on him, thinking about him, praising him, singing songs of him. See, we're worried about going out and witnessing and evangelizing when all we have to do is live our life according to him in relationship, and that witness will show itself.
Yes.
Yes.
I don't have to necessarily go out and start going and find people. When people find me in a good mood and I'm praising him and they say, what is that? That's gospel, honey. Let me tell you what it says. It says Jesus Christ came, died, rose again, and now I'm forgiven. Just as fast as that, I get maybe 30 seconds at my window. And they say, what is that music? Nothing. That's gospel. It comes in all different varieties. Hip hop, dance, country, Southwest, Baptist, whatever you want. But the only thing you need to know is that they're talking about Jesus Christ died for you. Have you accepted me? I've gotten this week so many people come to my window and say, I'm baptized. What has that done for you? Because you're standing at my window holding another girl's hand. Because you're looking at a boy with lust and incest. So tell me what baptism did for you. They can't answer that. Ask me, when's the last time you read your Bible? Sunday in church, exactly. You're looking at the wrong thing. You're not ready for baptism. What you need to be is in your word. That's your focus. So you want to show somebody that you can get all the glory. That's why they got baptized. So they can say, I'm baptized. Where's God in that? Where's God in that? I said, oh, Lord. And he said, okay. And he gave me so much. So I got to leave Jonathan a little bit of time. Hallelujah. But I'm going to give you the dream that he gave me. This week, and everybody knows I work at Hinkley. I've been praying and seeking God about relationship, and he took me in my dream, and I was half awake and I was half asleep. And I don't do enrollment, I do attendance. And these two women came into Hinkley. This is the dream. Came into Hinkley to enroll this young man at our school. And the building wasn't set up like Hinkley High School. It was set up like a, I don't know if you guys know about Kaiser Permanente.